Scandalous. You can't touch me. I'm ripping it, taking over the country.
Scandalous.
You gotta love me. I'm flipping it, representing Andy.
Scandalous.
You gotta feel me. Tip your cup and get with me.
Scandalous.
If you don't see me, best believe you're gonna hear me.
You can call me delirious. For me, it's not a mental challenge. I just like to bust. I'm serious. A message to cats.
Beautiful girl in Africa.
So glamorous, I bomb atomically, come back ever as contagious. Ambitious, I be the shit, it's not ambiguous. They say they want a lady in streets, but a freaking bed.
You need to go on a retreat.
Fantasies are in your head, cause I'm reality.
Of 13, 15, she's still like.
Can't touch me. I'm not gonna take over the country.
We anchor. Remember. We put me just up procrastinate. This is almost like a retreat where we. Re-anchoring, remembering, reigniting, brainstorming. How would you describe?
Hey, Bruce. Thank God this deck has not got a mouth and not got a memory. Because it could tell quite a few stories. Right?
I'm sure I need.
It's a cool deck,
it's beautiful.
Nice. I like my trees, I like my forest.
I mean, I remember before the deck was even built.
Yeah, can you remember?
Before the pool.
There was a slope, eh? There was a slope here from the. Only this piece of the house was here.
Yeah.
That wasn't there, and the pool wasn't there. It was just like a slope down here, and a big tree in the back garden. Yeah. And Bernadette's father cut down when he came out when we got married. He chopped this big mother tree down while we were on holiday. Don't ask me how he did it, man. It was a big tree. Yeah, and then all of these trees. There was nothing, bro. The sand. Amazing.
And the dog?
God, shame, man. It was, remember, you didn't know George?
Yeah, as I'm
you
saying.
You know Jingus?
George and Jingus the first.
Remember Jingus? Jingus, the black one with the long hair, the German Shepherd cross Rottweiler. The hectic one. Mm-hmm. Blew his record was biting three people in one day.
Oh my God.
He came here once. I was working with this guy, a mate of mine, Brian. Cool, like, okay. Computer whiz kid. And then this chick, this cool chick, but like a hippie. Like, she was like this, like, hey, man, like wow, man. He came from a mountain kind of chick with these big robes and stuff, okay. Anyway, so they come to visit me because Brian's going to help me with my computer. And Brian and me are working now. Jingus fucking attack people, okay?
You know, Jingus come,
yeah. But we did a puppy, yeah. But then he grew up, but it's a long story why he came up. People were shooting, kids were shooting off the neighbor's roof with a pellet gun, and the long story is that he got mauled, you know? Anyway, so I locked this dog in the toilet, okay? He had a tongue to his toilet. And I think, okay, well, that keeps the dogs out of the way. Brian can fix the thing, the chick sitting in the lounge chip. And I don't click, but I hear her puts the fork past me to the toilet. And as I hear the door open, it's clicking. Oh fuck. The dog. And I'm out of the chair and I run. And I get there in time to see her. She's got the door open and she's like looking at the dog, and the dog, his eyes were yellow. And he's like, fucking went for the dog, as I went for the dog, Bruvia's like a fucking woodpecker. Cha-cha-cha-cha-cha-cha-cha. Fucked her whole fucking leg up, like in 20 seconds. This dude's red shirts. With a day in the old house where the guy was shooting with a pellet gun, one day we had a braai, okay? With my sister and my two sisters and my parents and the whole family there. And my, sister gets a bit tipsy, has too much wine, and goes, hello, dog, what up? The dog goes to my sister. We take her to hospital. The brother-in-law's had a bit pissed. He goes to the dog, I'm not scared of you. What up? The dog jumps in. Take him to hospital. the neighbor looks over the fence to see what's going on. Whack! Neighbor. Three oaks in one day. Oh yeah, but people, if you left him alone, if he's there, leave him alone. He's not a friend, he's a beautiful dog, but don't go to him. He's not. He's going to take you to pieces. No matter how good
you are. Who would be your
parents? Hey, you.
Just you.
Yeah. And Bernadette, he tolerated Bernadette. That was before the kids, you know what I mean?
My dog was in the name George.
And, also George. My dog was George too.
Charles.
No?
And he listened to me. And they like to run the streets. If I wasn't there, and the garage opened and ran out and they would pull him back, I would be gone. If I couldn't, he would still have stopped and be like,
yeah. Oh, shit. Now, I had also met Big George, and then I had Bingo, the other dog. Beautiful dog.
I remember.
And both George and Bingo got poisoned. Crime in this place. Hey.
In life, but like dogs, you look at a dog, it's a somebody, it's alive.
No.
And all animals for that matter.
Yeah, I feel sorry for the cows and cats. I mean, everyone loves dogs, and everyone has cats and pets. Yeah, okay, then we get a couple of the endangered species that get locked up in cages and zoos, which is fucking frightening. And everyone loves them, there's conservation, you've got to protect the line. Oh, yeah, push it, protect the line.
Yeah.
But hey, my brother, those fucking cows and pigs and chickens, they pile them through by the millions and in inhumane conditions, imaginable.
You know,
and in Pakistan, the rainbow, what's the beef? Corona. Hey, Corona beef, is that Corona beef? What is that beef? Sounds like Corona. From Heidelberg. Corona beef, but sure it was Corona beef, eh? Hey, how's that? Was it Corona beef? Fucking shake it up. It's a something like that.
The point is, it's beef.
What was the point? You've got so many double standards. You've got a double standard that protects, you know, the dolphin, they fuck the tuna, protect the lion, but eh, the pig must just cut. You know what I mean? But what is right? I mean, it comes down to this whole story, are we masters of all we survey? I mean,
then also at this point, answer for ourselves as to where you are, your experience. I just stopped eating that type of life. Just because I couldn't get enough. Because what's better than one, the chicken or the egg or the cow or the pig? It's all life. And you talked about plant life in that tennis, do you understand? What can you do with it?
Yeah, you're the best that your convictions is what you understand.
You're the best that you can do it.
But I don't think there's any absolute right to thing. I mean, yes, we need to eat vegetables. No, we don't understand vegetable consciousness, but they say that vegetables do have consciousness. We talked about this in Iraq, but apparently there's some cheese, some kind of in the bush now. Where these giraffes going to eat the leaves off the top of the fucking tree. And the trees sense this and they know and they push out some kind of a scent or some kind of an enzyme that makes the leaves sound. But not only do they do it on their tree, they send out the signals that all the trees in that area start pushing out the enzyme to make their leaves taste shit. So the giraffe has to move out to protect. So there's communication, but we don't understand that. Intellect, we don't understand the communication element. But we are so presumptuous, we think that our understanding of communication is the only reality. It is the only concept of understanding of communication. So if we don't understand it, it doesn't exist.
Oh, right there, the only right there.
Exactly, everything's very humane, that your master always surveyed.
But how can it change?
It's amazing how creation worked out so cool for humanity. I mean, it just made, God made all these laws that were just so fucking convenient for us, you know what I mean? It was like really cool for us to be human.
Of the 1% of the 0.04% of the non-universe.
And we've only been around for 300,000 or 400,000 years. My God, hey, they waited a long time for the main act, huh? Sure.
And is that either hopeful or scary? Because you're like, what more is the two of us, or how insignificant are we?
ethos?
No, I don't think we're insignificant. I think the whole world is broken into areas of the ethos, you know what I mean? No area is more insignificant for anything else. And if something's far away and we don't know about it, it's got no significance for us. But it doesn't make it more or less significant than us, no matter how big or how small. I don't think that the universe is weighted according to what you are. It's not like, okay, well, this is a gold part of the universe, and this is a diamond, and this is a sewage part. It's all the universe. The shit is as much a part of the universe as the diamond. The shit is fertilizing the soil, which gives it up to growth, and wah, 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 and the Germans are making money for rich people that don't give a shit. But both of them have got their purpose in the greater scheme, all of them decay and fall apart and fertilize the soil. And that's on this little planet. But what's happening elsewhere, is it any more or less relevant? I don't think we've got a feel of significance, because we don't judge our we do judge our significance on materialism. But I don't think that is what the richness of us is about, is what we look like, how big we are, what we own, this kind of thing. That is insignificant. But our consciousness is. I mean, I watched a movie the other day, an animation movie about on the Day of the Dead, and how these people, that people in the afterlife, they actually fade away when they're no longer remembered by people on Earth. So the memory keeps them alive in a sense of way. And that seems to make sense to me, that your consciousness and your memories, I think, enrich the universe, the consciousness of the universe. And that's where you do play a role, and that's where visualization and all of the things of how to turn around and project and achieve things by positive thinking work. Because they tap into the universe and they orchestrate, like they twist, almost like, yeah, it's almost bending the universe like density bends light. It bends the universe to your way, and the positivity is what feeds the universe, and that never goes. The same as matter is never destroyed and energy is always conserved. The same, I think, the consciousness is somehow conserved, not in the memories as we see them, but within the intelligence of the God intellect.
Hence, how are you going to win if you ain't right within? I'm a Lauryn Hill saying that song. How are you going to win if you ain't right within? What within is, you be truly are that. If you look in and you check your within, who you are actually, you must be able to love who you are, because that's part of.
Yeah, that's self-esteem. But I say,
but it's to recognize.
The question, of course, is understanding what is right within. Is there an absolute right? What are we saying?
It's the feeling, that's the feeling that it's all right.
And what gives you that feeling of all right? Is it money? Is it wealth?
So
it's a lot of times, I mean, let's face it, if you didn't have what we have, a house, place, chill place, the life would be very different. So to say, well, it's own, it's got nothing to do with materialism.
But you're all months behind on our pond.
Yeah, but fucking enjoy it while you can.
So, but what I'm saying is, I'm just able to have a bit. I'm like the optimist of all. This is what you're visualizing and trying to manifest. But at the moment, we're having to adapt. And I'm not even just talking about us, but about everyone. Is having to make whatever they have, you know, work for them. And we're hanging on to our commitments. The bank just wants to smash. But at the same time, everyone needs to be given some sort of space to recover.
Conan has put the world in pause. So, yeah, the banks are going to jump up and down. Of course they are, because their little clocks keep ticking. And they're still ticking on interest and every kind of thing. But everything else is in pause. So even the poor people that would have to come and repossess the houses are shooting fucking on pockets. So at the moment, it's given us
a gap. Just their job.
It's given us a time for us to think about life. It's given us an opportunity for humanity, for every single person, anyone that is going through this experience and is not reflecting on their role, on the life and their existence, is mentally challenged. How's that for a nice PC about it? They don't fucking think, they're fucking insane.
You know, you tell me, how's a guy that works at a bank's legal department who's chasing the debt for the bad money? So say they're chasing me from before Corona. Now they know Corona's messed up everyone's budgets and everything. But they still come in to ask those same questions. And how do they feel knowing for obvious there's a reason why everyone is behind on their payments? It's because everyone's been in the nuts with it. raising capital and stuff.
And then on a Sunday they
they're
go
still
going to
gonna come and bug.
And on a Sunday they go to church, they fucking destroy people, take people's houses away. And then on a Sunday they go to church and say, God, please forgive me because I love my neighbor and here's my tithe and hallelujah, fucking hallelujah. And I'm good. And then on Monday they go, and on the road to work they give the $5,000 to the beggar that's begging. And then they go and they stand with the executive to retrench another couple of thousand people and to turn around and lift their prices, squeeze the economy, fuck up people in general, but they don't see them as people, they see them as statistics.
But this one,
because
I'm
they bow to the neon gods we make. The corporates are seen as gods above religion, above humanity, above family, above an entity that is a listing on a company register and has a logo and a brand, as seen as above everything else in our lives. It is the thing that gives us the money to pay for accommodation and pay for food, and we bow to this neon god. And we will listen to the rules, who we don't know who made them or why they made them, but we will adhere to them. And where they tell us we must shout together for the company, we shout together, and then we come home and we cry to the wife because we're not making enough money to cover the bond and feed the baby. But we accept it.
And how is that person feeling about how they are being, because people are all aware, just
how
aware. So they've got to know, listen, everyone's going through shit. I know they're going through shit. I'm still going to give them shit about what they're going through, which is shit, just like I am. You know what I'm saying?
But the people are all confused because they're going and they're obeying the laws. They see they're obeying the laws and then people are doing shit. The people that don't obey the laws get further and further above the law. So we're seeing all of these paradoxes. They wonder why you're feeling anxious and why we're feeling hostile and feeling aggressive. We can't, because we are obeying the fucking laws, but they're not making things better.
So now,
and so the what is the answer? Is the answer to rebel? Is it to start going in the street and just burning and screaming shit?
It's the lock, because we just fucking own shit up.
It's the word.
What do you do?
It's the spreading of the word. It's telling people, say, bucking the system is no longer the lunatic fringe. It's not the insane people of the planet that are saying something's fucking wrong. It's a sensible, but then you get these Antifa fucks and these extreme lefts and right going around, the right, these big, ugly, fat, fucking white people going around doing weird shit and breaking and going and wanting to fuck up the darkies. And then you've got the Antifa people breaking all the shit down because it's time for Black Lives Matter. I mean, what the fuck? Where are people turning around saying, well, I tell you what, instead of trying to get rid of the shit of the past, let's stop making shit from this point forward. Let's solve problems. Let's get together and say, hey, this is not a question of race or anything. This is a question of the top 1% that orchestrate the media, that orchestrate business, that own the businesses where we make our bread and money, squeezing us. And as long as we are divided and squabbling between ourselves, we will never turn and understand that my 8 hours of work are worth as much as 8 hours of work of a sewer cleaner, and as much as 8 hours work of a doctor. It is blackmail for a doctor to charge what he charges because he holds me to blackmail for my fucking health. You don't pay this, you die, you get sick. Now what would happen if a fucking plumber said to the doctor, well, you don't turn around and pay me your fucking rates, so you can wallow in your own shit. But we don't do this because we're part of the system, and as long as they make us feel threatened and that we can't do it without it, and we need the systems and we need the governments. Through, think about government. I've got this weird kind of sort of like almost the caveman. What was that caveman comic strip character? Remember even? What was it called? It was a comic strip, and he had like a big club. And
Captain Caveman.
One of those kind of guys. And I had this picture. Can you imagine in the early days, Captain Caveman? Hey, there was this community of cavemen living in the cave. And there were these fucking big motherfuckers that went out every day and they killed the fucking antelope and they brought it home and they fucking gave it to the woman, cooked it on the fire. They were very fucking gender inequality those days. The woman fucking cooked, the man hunted. And the woman grew fucking moustaches in the hair and the arm. But they went there and then the fucking... and then they went out, the guys caught the lions and they made fucking fur for the woman and they made miniskirts for the men. It was fucking amazing. But there was this one motherfucker good at shit. He couldn't hunt, he couldn't do, he couldn't say, he just waited around and went, can I help you, can I help? And they said, okay, but I'll tell you what you do. While we're doing the shit, the next morning, come clear the fucking firewood out, pack some more firewood, get rid of the bones, throw shit on the pile outside and do it. And he became the first administrator. Mm-hmm. So he was a public servant. And they sort of got bored of the fucking layabouts, they turned around and ministered. What the fuck happened? Where did this thing turn around that they became the leaders? They're the administrators, they keep the shit tidy. They are not there to govern and come up with big decisions. That's business. A church, even, virtue commas. Clever people, educated people, universities, people, intellects of minds that come together and should tell us how the fuck we do it. These guys get rid of the shit, make the roads sure the roads are tidy, fill the potholes.
How do you get the right minds in the position where they can make
the right minds are in the position, but we have moved into the situation saying, for me to contribute to life, I need to be rewarded. We don't turn around, we've lost focus of the fact that it is a right to have what I have, but it is a duty to contribute towards the solution. We've turned around and be big with the rights. Yeah, it's my right to have a house, it's my right to have all of these kind of things. But no one's turned around and said, yes, but as a patriotic citizen, you have obligations to your fellow human being and to your country to contribute and make a difference. So if you're not contributing, you're not fulfilling your end of the fucking agreement. So therefore, you cannot claim the benefits of that society. So once we turn around and move the mindset of humanity to say, we should do willingly, with a good heart, our part to make a better world, we will start to make a difference. But as long as we say we deserve rewards, we deserve incentives, and we deserve payment simply for contributing, our mindset is wrong. And this is the whole problem of society. We've lost our value system. We've lost honor. We've lost integrity. That those are no longer measures of a man's character. It's wealth. It's power. It's connections. All of the, it's the negative attributes that before were thought of as evils are now seen as assets in a human person. And then we wonder why we're at war, we wonder why business is falling apart, we wonder why society is falling apart, and we wonder why the fuck we hate each other. We no longer have a barometer, we no longer have a ruler, we don't know how to judge each other, and everyone's on social media and is too scared to have a conversation, because when you get on social media or on WhatsApp or something, I can prepare my conversation. I can prepare what I'm presenting. I don't take my fucking clothes off and say, this is me. And I think this is what's destroyed what it means to be human and, the, and what it meant to have friendships.
Give me a bulletproof vest. It's just time to use everything for the right reasons and get the message out as clear as possible. Because it is what it is, that there's so many different perceptions, because everyone's going through something at the same time, on top of what they were going through. Corona's acted like an extra drop kick.
No, Corona fucking.
Was lifted, it's God given, God bless, and God gifted.